5:30, and I believe I'm starting on time. So, welcome. Thank you all for coming out to this at 5:30 on Wednesday. It's kind of a weird time, but I appreciate it nonetheless. For those of you that don't know, my name is Kevin Everly, and I am presenting this lecture on camp in Francis Poulenc's trio for partial fulfillment for the DMA of Assume. Before I start, I want to share with you an anecdote, though. I like stories. Poulenc's trio is probably my favorite piece of chamber music. It was the first piece of chamber music I played when I became a professional, and I've played it numerous times since. I feel like numerous times in the past month I've played it. Every year when we go to the International Double Reed Society convention, someone is playing it somewhere on a stage or a hallway or a parking garage. When I came to UNLV, I knew I wanted to do something about the trio because it's such an important work for oboists and bassoonists, and it's such an important work in Poulenc's overall output. I just didn't know what I was going to do, and so I thought, well, I'll just start my run-of-the-mill usual analysis and we'll get out of here scot-free. But then I found an article by Christopher Moore called Camp and Francis Poulenc's Early Ballets. And it was this article that changed my perspective. The article is about two ballets from Poulenc's early period, Les Biches and Abat. And what Christopher Moore talks about is this idea of a camp aesthetic. And so I had a question and said, well, the trio lies chronologically directly between Les Biches and Abat. So I wonder if these traits that Christopher Moore is identifying exist in this work as well. And so that led me to a second question. What is camp? The earliest definitions of camp come from J. Ring Ware's Dictionary of Victorian Vernacular around 1909, and he defined it this way. Actions and gestures of exaggerated emphasis, probably from the French, used chiefly by persons of exceptional want of character, as in, what a very camp he is. By 1923, Eric Partridge's New English Dictionary had defined camp as being effeminate and theatrical. And it classified camp as a trait of dramatically effeminate homosexual man. In the same dictionary the following year, in 1924, it added camp as a verb, to camp, meaning to exhibit humorously exaggerated, dramatic, effeminate mannerisms, usually exclusively of homosexual men. As an aesthetic, these definitions, you can tell that these definitions belong to the gay community, albeit not a very good depiction of the gay community. But the arts have a very rich tradition of homosexual authorship, particularly around the turn of the century, with figures like Oscar Wilde, Aubrey Beardsley, and Jean Cocteau. So it's logical that these exaggerated, effeminate, theatrical mannerisms would bleed into art, especially movements like Art Nouveau, Surrealism, and importantly for Poulenc, Neoclassicism. Contemporary scholarship surrounding camp aesthetics is divided into two different camps, if you will. Reception, meaning camp as a reaction to art, and inscription, meaning camp as an inherent part of art and of the creative process. Susan Sontag believes that camp is an area of reception. She was a feminist writer who wrote a landmark essay called Notes on Camp in 1964. In this essay, Sontag claims camp is not an aesthetic, but rather an artistic sensibility, a way of seeing and experiencing art, quote, a sensibility that, among other things, converts the serious into the frivolous. For Sontag, camp reactions are based on the understanding and acknowledgement of artifice, exaggeration, and theatricality in a work of art. These elements are typically humorous or ironic in nature, but are meant to be completely serious, not a parody of themselves. By Sontag's definition, camp art is typically something passing for what it's not. Thus, camp as a reaction typically comments on juxtaposed binaries, and a very good example of that is this Aubrey Beardsley drawing. As a principle of Art Nouveau, we see several binaries at work. White and black, we have good versus evil, as demonstrated by these little air horns. Active versus passive, there's clearly action by one subject in the drawing and passivity by the other. A critical reading of this by Laura Zaplin makes note of the black coffee in front of the woman of white. Completely devoid of cream, thus the presence of men, which influences this reception as being a sapphic encounter. All of this comments on Victorian propriety and the role of women, and by extension, homosexuals, in society. The reaction to what we're seeing here is camp, according to Sondheim. The other side of the coin aligns camp with the creative process. This idea of camp as inscription was born out of contemporary scholarship as a reaction to Susan Sontag's definitions, which, according to sociologist Mo Meyer, appropriate camp from the gay community and turn it into a universal aesthetic. In order for camp to be an inherent part of the production of art, it must have gay authorship, as camp has historically been attributed to the gay community and is clearly a defining trait of the gay community, as we saw in the earlier definitions from the turn of the century. Additionally, there's intention on the part of the artist to utilize these elements. This intentionality is important because prior to this shift toward inscription, it had been thought, thanks to Sontag, that absolute music doesn't qualify as a camp subject. Sontag thought this because, by her account, absolute music is contentless, and it lacks something for an audience member to be objective about. Music, by her view, absolute music, is subjective. You make of it what you will. Ballet and opera, on the other hand, provide visual aspects for camp and draw the narrative for the audience member, thus being mostly inclined to her reception of art. But these art forms are informed by music. There would be no ballet without music. There would be no opera without music, or at least it would be a very different kind than what we know. And finally, camp as inscription means that the aestheticism of camp is that of the homosexual critique on the heteronormative narrative. When seen as an act of inscription rather than reception, camp art comments on heteronormative discourse in a subversive, masked way. As a synthesis of these elements, I've constructed a definition which blends the two ideals of camp, favoring camp as inscription, but taking into account camp as reception. These two ideals are crucial to a complete understanding of Poulenc's absolute music, because Poulenc's music, and indeed most camp music, is not only about the subversive homosexual underpinnings utilized by the composer, but also how the commentary on the heteronormative structures is received by audiences and, importantly, critics. Thus, the defining characteristics of the trio of camp, which I've analyzed in the trio, are gay authorship, which manifests a lot in absolute music, especially for Poulenc as autobiography. Juxtaposed binaries, this can be the major-minor binary, this can be timbral binaries, any sort of musical binary. Artifice, exaggeration, and theatricality, and a touch of humor, irony, or parody. So, this brings us to the man. Francis Poulenc had three distinct periods, the early, the middle, and the late. What we're concerned about, what I'm concerned about in my research, is the early period from 1917 to 1939. In his early period, Poulenc was experimenting with genres, particularly chamber music, and this is where most of his chamber music output happens. He's also developing a sense of neoclassic style, thanks to his associations with Stravinsky and Cocteau. It's my contention that camp is a defining element in Poulenc's early period, especially the latter part, where Poulenc is not only maturing in terms of his compositional style, but also sexually, and becoming aware of the sexual other through his artistic and personal associations, especially with that of Jean Cocteau. To provide evidence for the camp style of this period, and specifically his absolute music, I refer back to Christopher Moore's identified camp elements in Les Biches and Abad, which for me inform the queer elements in the trio as specifically camp. Les Biches is a ballet written for the Ballet Russe in 1924. Moore points out that a lot of the same elements that I find in the trio are also in Les Biches. In Les Biches, the musical elements influence the visual elements, as with this androgynous character, the woman in blue. It's a little bright, I don't know if you can see it very well in the photo, but she's a woman dancer wearing essentially a man's leotard. You can see very clearly the women behind her are in traditional long gowns with feathery things. Her hair is pulled back, and she's very tightly clothed, as most men are. The masculine and the feminine are embodied in her lyrical melodies, which are interrupted by the aggressive, dryly articulated chromaticism, which you can't hear, but that's okay. Liebisch also relies heavily on character development and the musical representation of the other. The character of the hostess blurs the lines between an organic, biological female and a man simply passing in a drag performance. This is represented musically by the combination of a rag and a mazurka to represent the hostess. Additionally, Poulenc uses subtext and he uses poetry to do so. One example is the Petite Chanson d'Assez, where Poulenc inserts the folk song with a double meaning to comment on lesbian dancing being performed on stage. When looking at the reception versus inscription subsects of camp, Liebisch ascribes to both. Henri Mahler notes that the neoclassical form as a mask for the heated eroticism is present. This statement is in reaction to what queer theorist Lee Sedgwick calls the typifying gesture of camp aesthetics, of autobiography, and queer awareness. This typifying gesture manifests in the camp elements of the androgynous woman, the sexual ambiguity and prowess of the hostess, and the lesbian and double entendre of the song in the Petite Chanson. Abad, on the other hand, utilizes issues of autobiography and more harmonic subversion as the elements of the camp aesthetic. Abad was written 4 years after Liebisch and during a time that biographer Miriam Chemeney calls Poulenc's deep depressive crisis. This was because in 1928, Poulenc had proposed marriage to a childhood friend, Raymond Messier. She rejected him, and he then immediately began an affair with the painter Richard Charlon. This plot of Abad, conceived by Poulenc himself, concerns the depiction of the Greek goddess Diana being torn between chastity and erotic desire, much as what Poulenc is going through in his own personal life. This then creates an allegorical scenario, which Poulenc uses as a mask for his own struggles with deviance and the internal struggle of heterosexual chastity. Musically, Poulenc subverts the erotic, which we read here as homosexual, subtext by having Diana's musical representation, her themes, adopt other themes and other stylistic traits of the heterosexual woman around her. Poulenc uses chromaticism to interrupt the tonal chastity of Diana, representing her turmoil by semitonal conflict. Moore asserts that Poulenc also uses the piano, which Poulenc did play at the premiere, as the musical harbinger for Diana, even more obviously connecting the autobiographical element. Finally, Poulenc uses form to both align and subvert Diana to the heteronormative discourse. One side of Diana's psychological state follows form, follows the construction of either a sonata form or the waltz that she's dancing, and the other side, the erotic side, the deviant side, alters that form slightly. Now what we came here for. The trio for oboe, bassoon, and piano. The trio was written in 1926 and dedicated to Manuel Zafaia. The trio was, by all accounts of all of his major biographers, Poulenc's greatest achievement in chamber music from this period. Indeed, the trio remains a staple of the chamber repertoire for winds. The trio is also notable because it is the first chamber work of Poulenc's to utilize piano as part of the instrumentation. His chamber works previous to this, the sonata for two clarinets, the sonata for clarinet and bassoon, and the trio for horn, trumpet, and trombone, are merely exercises in writing for wind instruments and fail to produce true idiomatic writing. Critics perceive these as being too pianistic in the wind writing, especially the sonata for two clarinets. The trio allows Poulenc to utilize his pianistic writing abilities and also experiment with more idiomatic wind writing. There are universal traits in camp, and there are traits which are unique to a movement. Universally, many of the camp elements have to do with formal manipulation, manipulation of the structure, just as Poulenc would later do in Abad with Diana. Harmonic juxtaposition, including a constant desire to flatten key areas so they do not reach full maturation. Humor, theatricality, and instrumental characterization, particularly of the piano, as we'll see in a minute. Camp elements, which are movement-specific, speak to autobiography and commentary on the heteronormative discourse. It is accurate to say that there is a heteronormative discourse running through the entire piece, but the way in which it's interacted with and commented upon changes in each movement. On the whole, the representations of the instruments bear a great deal of attention. In the camp discourse, the piano acts as the heteronormative narrative, underpinning the direction and contextualization of the wind parts. in essence, the piano is what drives the form. And when the form is commented upon, it is up to the piano to subjugate the change and correct it. Indeed, several times throughout the work, the piano corrects something that goes awry in the wind parts. These episodes mark a campy commentary on the heteronormative discourse. Poulenc, all too aware of the social undercurrent and taboo status of homosexuality in the 20s, allows this subversion to be subjugated and corrected, maybe as a broader commentary. The bassoon is the main carrier of the gay discourse, often altering the piano's harmonic direction or interrupting the discourse altogether to insert something brand new. The bassoon is also the line which is corrected more often than not, and in doing so, becomes the passive voice, just as, socially, the homosexual should be, by the heteronormative narrative, the passive role. The oboe then acts as savior, the not really so neutral voice, which reaffirms the heteronormative narrative and aids in correcting the bassoon's othering. The first movement, presto, is exemplified through manipulation of the form, an introduction, the juxtaposition of major, minor, binary, binary, major, minor, binary. I was going to say that. Major, minor, binary. The interlude, which some people read as a retransition to the recapitulation. In a 1953 interview with Claude Rossal, Poulenc said that the first movement, marked presto, was modeled after a typical Haydn Allegro movement. However, the form is only somewhat connected to Haydn Allegro, and it's really only because it's in a very loose ternary form. Poulenc's structure is based in ternary, but doesn't follow the typical harmonic conventions of tonic dominant motion or any sort of related key motion. In fact, from the outset, Poulenc clears the form by beginning his presto movement with a slow, recitative-like introduction, contrasting the supposed homage to Haydn and delaying the start of the movement. We can see here, if we just look at Poulenc's form, we have an insertion of the other narrative, which the piano starts in A minor. It doesn't really move the way it should. It goes to B flat major, which is then subjugated to the minor. Cadence is on E and sets up the exposition, but should move from A minor to E major if we're going with convention. The exposition then doesn't go to the dominant. It mixes the mode. We go from A minor to A major to A minor to A major, and back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth. But let's talk about this introduction, because it is so different. The piano in Poulenc's introduction sets the minor key moving through the movement's exposition, even though the movement's exposition is in major. The minor tonality does not last for long, and is subverted by the bassoon's entrance with a motivic idea which is unique to the introduction, and not at all related to anything in the exposition. The bassoon's phrase exists in a major tonality, which the piano only briefly entertains, trying to figure out how to get back to the minor key it wants. The oboe's phrase then corrects the major otherness of the bassoon phrase, returning the phrase to minor, albeit B-flat minor and not A minor. It's also curious that for a presto movement, we start with a lento introduction, and the metronome marking is 76, arguably fast for a lento. We can see here, this is the beginning, this is the introduction of the movement with a brief harmonic analysis. We see that the piano is in A minor, briefly entertaining B-flat, cadencing on the dominant. The bassoon then comes in. The piano responds with dissonance, tonicizes into E-flat major, and then just continues with half whole stepwise motion, down, 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 until finally cadencing on B-flat. A recitative-like structure happens. By the time we get up to the end of the run, the oboe brings us back to minor. So we see here that the piano, as the heteronormative discourse, has established something as a minor tonality, and the bassoon, as commentary, changes it to not only major, but major a half step higher. The oboe, having none of it at all, subjugates this and says, well, if you're not going to be in A minor, you're going to be in B flat minor. This is why we get the savior metaphor from the oboe. It saves the tonality, it saves the heteronormative narrative, and saves the discourse from being otherwise completely altered. This is a type of correction that happens frequently throughout the work. As the exposition gets underway, Poulenc doesn't shift the discourse to the dominant key. instead mixing modes of the tonic key, suggesting a resistance to the normal construction. The themes are humorous and jaunty, which in themselves mask the subtle harmonic queerness of the exposition. We can see that from the beginning of the true presto, he's playing with us. A major, A minor, A major, descending down almost inaudibly. This mixture is a juxtaposition of the straight and gay narratives, trying to figure out in what way are we going to land. There's a power struggle happening here. The development section consists of new themes, again, a commentary on the normal discourse of high mesoternary form. The camp element here comes from the harmonic language of the development, which rests directly between what it should be. The B section would traditionally shift to the dominant and its related keys, as it does most of the time. Here, though, the hearing circles around F, which we read as a flat six to an A major relationship, where we just cadence. The development section is divided into two themes, one in F minor and one in F major, at least balancing the tonal difference. This leads to a traditional cadence in F major by way of an implied piccolo third. Between the development section and the recapitulation, Pulling inserts an interlude, which by typical Haydn convention should not be there. We can see here the end of the exposition into the development. We clearly cadence A major, very nice, very clean. Then we move here into something marginally related to F minor until we get to the oboe solo, which clearly reads us in. This interlude explores key areas and acts more as a romantic style development than the B section does. This interlude passes for completely normal, all the themes are totally centered, and are all supported with appropriate consonant harmonies, even if the harmonic structure is off a bit. However, just when everything seems right with the world, Kulang interrupts this narrative by inserting the bassoon solo from the introduction directly in to the interlude. It's now contextualized in the minor mode, however, instead of the major mode. The piano, in syncopations which shift the emphasis of time, chromatically denigrates the harmonic structure until, once again, the oboe acts as savior, pulling the harmonies out to a consonant E major by way of half-step motion, which sets up the dominant in order to recapitulate. Without this oboe-saving act, we may not end up there at all, and the heteronormative discourse would be forever gone. However, it doesn't matter. This is where the bassoon line is inserted into the interlude. It's the exact same pitch set, spelled differently, as the beginning. The piano, though, is trying very hard, unlike what it did in the introduction, where it surprisingly tried to give up and move. It's trying to move it along by queering its own beat, by trying to get the bassoon to not be able, to not be steady, to not be stable within the narrative. So hopefully we just give up. The recapitulation is shortened and focuses more on the A major tonality than A minor, in an apparent attempt to pass as a normal recapitulation, as it would Haydn. However, the bassoon once again interrupts this, foreshadowing a theme from the third movement, which we can see at rehearsal 18, and obscures the tonal center into the coda before being corrected by the piano to eventually cadence in A major. You still there? Still with me? Okay, I'm not sure I am, but okay. We're going to play for you now the first movement of the Pulang Trio. I'm joined at the piano by Dr. Nicole Sook and on oboe by Daniel Nunez. So please, let this digest.
No. Thank you.
The Adamante movement is the subtlest of the three movements in terms of its alignment with the camp aesthetic. Just as with all of the movements, the Andante begins with the piano providing the model for the melodic and harmonic activity to come. This theme is reminiscent of an opera aria, perhaps Bellini, with the melismatic ending in the phrase. This opening theme appears only three times in the movement. If the piano sets up the structure, as it should, being the heteronormative discourse, then the bassoon camps it up the second time it enacts. The bassoon narration appears in D-flat major, creating a minor third relationship between the B-flat opening of the piano line, the D-flat here, but both being major. The second half of the phrase moves to E minor and stays there. It doesn't cadence in major, as the piano's theme originally does. Here we have B-flat major, B-flat major, B-flat major, inflection of a B-flat minor-like melody, and then we come back to the major key again. Here, we don't do that. We're in a D-flat major-like tonality, then we come into E minor and stay there. The heteronormative discourse with the key change has pulled us in and aligned us with its own intentions. The bassoon line doesn't get to finish in the same manner, and instead is relegated to a different harmonic paradigm based on coercion by the piano. This is highlighted even more as an act of subversion when the oboe enters in the subsequent phrase, playing the correct major, major, minor, major pattern, thus correcting the tonal focus and modulating back to the major. Through the oboe's movement to B major, the piano is then free by normal conventions to modulate to E minor, which it does for the second theme area, and all is right with the world. The two wind parts play off of each other in a dialogue section supported by traditional harmonic progression. The section eventually recapitulates in F, but that breaks with the normal convention with the appropriate relationship to what came before. This is now a semitonal shift. We've gone a half step, differently than where we should be. And Poland would do this later in a body. The final instance of the opening material is humorously manipulated through the usage of these gracements in the bass hand, which create a bumbling sort of bass line, similar to that music depicting the American West, while not thinking of the Grand Canyon Suite, any of those cartoons depicting a mule. You may think, after all, what's gayer than a cowboy? The theme follows all the conventions of its first iteration, major antecedent statement, inflected minor consequent, and cadencing in major, but with a slight twist. Interestingly, though, the movement finishes in F minor, by way of an altered major scale of 6 degrees flat. This alteration is suggested by the bassoon's answers to the oboe solo just before this final phrase. And it's short. Thank you. that same 1953 Chicago Sonnet interview that I mentioned earlier, Pouwant states the third movement of the trio is modeled after the rondo in Camille Saint-Saëns' second piano concerto. Again, much like Haydn, the similarities are bare to say the least. Pouwant's rondo is similar to Saint-Saëns in that it follows the five-part rondo structure. But Pouwant uses several more motives than Saint-Saëns does, 10 in all. This exaggeration of the number of motives in itself provides an element of camp. Yes, rondo should be motivic. Yes, this is overkill. Yes, that's the point. Whereas Saint-Saëns' motives are fewer and more drawn out, more developed, Pouwant's motives are several and short. The A section consists of four motives, all light, bouncy themes with the occasional flourish, a big, frivolous free-for-all. The first A section is marked gay, léger, and sec. With these directions, Pouwant is trying to cast a markedly different mood here from that of the first movement, which is also constructed around this secco, dry articulation. Where the first movement secco is subject to the constant shift from major to minor, this light, airy, gay opening is meant to feel different. Of all the motives are in major and progress rather traditionally in terms of their harmony. And then this happens. The B section begins to undermine the previous section's consonant harmonic language through the use of chromaticism. This chromaticism obscures the tonal center just as in previous movements between major and minor. This juxtaposition between the major and the minor induces an almost seasick-like progression, but it's all housed under a very stable, very steady F minor oboe, suggesting that something in the narrative, something is going on with our heterosexual brethren, and the O is trying to prove its role as savior once again by masking that change, by keeping the tonality the same and not succumbing to what the piano is doing. The solo is contextualized on a micro level through camp dissonance. The listener clearly hears the passage as F minor, and the oboe solo certainly suggests this, which we can hear. We're moving in that sort of tonality. However, the chromaticism in the piano accompaniment suggests various recontextualizations of this F minor pretense, altering the harmonic discourse and invoking an artificiality, or an artificial sense, of bitonality. The presence of this artificial bitonality, especially the presence of a tonal center ground F, which is at once major, minor, and diminished, depending on the beat, is a subversive moment in the narrative. Pouwant does not formally modulate, and in fact ends the A section as the dominant to B-flat minor, as the key would suggest. However, the oboe solo does not tonicize, but rather maintains the now minor dominant tonality in the context of B-flat minor. In other words, it maintains its F status through the B-flat major, thus changing its role from tonic-inducing solo line to now dominant supporting solo line. This only highlights the attempt of the oboe to mask the change. No, everything is fine. F works no matter what. It masks the change brewing in the piano part, trying to figure out how it fits within the new narrative, overtaken now by the wind. In this harmonically unstable section, it is now assumed the very embodiment of gay autobiography throughout the movement, which comes to the rescue through an ascending chromatic line, which realigns the tonality to a consonant F minor, turning the tables now on what is deemed correct. This happens again later, but unnecessarily, which makes that moment actually quite curious. The bassoon has come to save the day, and the day does not need saving. During the final A section, the bassoon interrupts the motivic structure by inserting a minor motive directly into the motivic fold without any regard for setup or transition. This abrupt change shaves an eighth note from the previous phrase and presents a certain theatricality to the statement. This does not last long, however, as Pouwant uses the piano to reestablish the dominance of the heteronormative narrative by interrupting the bassoon's frivolous foray with material from the second theme area of the first movement. Why is this important? Well, this is important because that was the peak of the dominant structure of the heteronormative narrative in the first movement. When all is reassert your dominance, and that's exactly what is happening here. By inserting this material here, the piano is at once reestablishing its dominance of the heteronormative narrative, while also breaking the conventional rondo by marking this as the beginning of the coda, rather than letting the section finish. In the first movement, the phrase is an F major. Here, though, the constant flattening provides a piece of camp commentary. Harmonic language does not quite resonate within the confines of Western diatonic tonal harmonic progressions. When this happens, it can be read as camp commentary on the heteronormative narrative, as it is purely an alteration of expectation, often exaggerating the harmonic other movement before returning to a correct tonal center. We see here in this example the chromaticism I was talking about with the bassoon part coming in, but also just maybe mirroring what's happening here, one way or the other. Still readjusting it to a clear cadence in F minor, even with a nice, perfectly stacked triad there for us. The bassoon gets one last interruption in before the final section of the coda. As this quote from the first movement is winding down, the bassoon interjects with a loud, heavily accented motive, which, in typical camp fashion, obscures the established consonant tonality of the preceding section. This commentary attempts to establish the gay discourse as embodied by the bassoon for most of the trio as the dominant narrative. The oboe joins the bassoon in this squabble as the piano ascends to the very, very, very top of its range. For all of this camp theatrical drama, the rondo ends rather unceremoniously and really plainly. The piano is truly accompanimental here, and the oboe and the bassoon play in unison. What has happened? Has the homosexual narrative joined the heterosexual? Has the heterosexual narrative given up? Did the gays win the day? Well, it's humorous, though, that a movement which has an exaggerated number of motives, very complicated harmonic dialogue, full of conflict, interruption, and subjugation, would end with a simple jaunty tune, harmonized only by simple spatterings of chords in the piano part. It's as if, with the sparsity of the piano, the heteronormative narrative matters less by the end of the trio. And the gay discourse has found its voice right at the last second. Let's listen to it, shall we? You white person.
Thank you.
the trio is a camp piece of art. And it has been received as such. Most of the biographers, the critics, any sort of analysis that talks about Poulenc in general, and specifically this piece, calls it humorous. It uses very small describers, cute, I've seen in three reviews. Chester, when it first published the catalog description of the trio, called it Poulenc's funny, quirky, cute little trio. A music publisher said that. Some elements are universal, and some are strategically placed in specific places, but the elements of camp do exist here. Furthermore, Poulenc's trio proves that the camp aesthetic can be applied to absolute music, creating the larger question of camp as style. Can camp be a style? Well, that's not the scope of this project, nor is it this presentation. I certainly believe that this research and the traits I've identified today align the piece of absolute music with camp and provide a sort of methodology for readings of other pieces which may be aligned to a camp aesthetic, and that may have further reaching implications. Thank you all so much for coming. Before I take questions, I'd like to just thank my colleagues again, Dr. Nicola Suk on piano and Daniel Nunez on the oboe for joining me this evening. If we could give them a hand.
Is there anywhere, I know you can't cover everything in 60 minutes, is there anything anywhere from Poulenc himself admitting or talking about camp elements in his trio or his ballet?
No. Not that I have found, I should say. The writing that Poulenc has done that is used in this kind of analysis are generally letters and diary entries that place him as a participant within gay culture and gay subculture, especially in Paris in the 20s and 30s, and then he goes to Monte Carlo and gets a little crazier,
right.
But I don't think, and I haven't seen any evidence of this in my limited research, but camp as an aesthetic kind of sphere didn't really start to blossom until the 60s. That was the terminology. Susan Sontag's essay, Notes on Camp from 64, is the first scholarly piece of camp criticism. And it's coming out of a period where you have, you know, Warhol and pop art and just this freedom of expression coming up. So I don't think that there would be writings by Poulenc ascribing it certainly to saying, you know, I'm camping because X, Y, Z, even though the vernacular existed, I don't think it was applied to art quite in the same way. But yes, we Christopher Moore does this a lot, and I've done a little bit of it in my own paper, of linking diary entries. There's a very famous letter in 1928 as he's writing a laude to Valentin Hugo, that talks about his dirty little secret and the fire he's holding inside with his relationship with Richard Chanier, which then, you know, he subsequently becomes the dedicatee of Abad. His sister-in-law is sent a copy, and so we make those connections in that way to say, like, there is intent here because of these personal actions, but Poulenc himself didn't, as far as I have found, didn't actually specifically help me say that.
Okay. And is there your findings, was sexuality, especially homosexuality, treated and viewed as differently in 1920s Paris as opposed to New York or London?
Well, what's funny, the comparison, I don't know. I can't speak to the comparison because I'm hyper-focused looking at Paris and especially in the enclave systems there. But what's funny is the Napoleonic Code, which was in force at the turn of the century into the 20s, didn't ban homosexuality. Homosexuality is cool. Do your own thing, right? But the police could arrest you for engaging in homosexual practices. It was just sort of an unspoken rule that it was, but it wasn't. In fact, the Napoleonic Code, when you look at it, is actually kind of campy. You know, it is a rule that you can be, and we'll look the other way unless we need to arrest you, and then we'll go ahead and do it because you can do it. You can, you know, it's like the DMV. You know, it doesn't make any sense. But yeah, in Paris, so you have these enclaves, and you have private salon parties. The Abad actually was premiered at a salon party, and was written for this group of people, and that's the same party that Poulenc went around without pants on, and you know, there's a lot of sort of anecdotal things like that and attitude shifts. But I mean, Jean Cocteau, probably the gayest figure of French modernism, was heavily involved with Boyne and Lacy's. So for them, I think it was a different experience than for a non-musician or someone not in any of those sorts of social
norms. So it's more like a social moray than a codified.
Yes. So much for coming. I'll hang out here a little bit if you have a question you want to ask, like, what were all those words you said? But thank you again so much for coming. Please drive safe and have a great day.